liking each other. We don't want to have a battle here with anyone. And we've been meeting about every 2 weeks with Jeff. He's been very cooperative. And we just bat around ideas. And he goes back and spends a couple of weeks and tries to incorporate the ideas we come up with. And we're getting it narrowed down. The last meeting we had about a week ago, we gave Jim 3 weeks to put his ideas down. Leave us out of it. Tell us what we should be doing or should not be doing, and then we'll look at that. And I think we're gaining. We're really getting along well. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other committee reports? Well, at this time then, I will turn the meeting over to Stan, who will introduce our speaker of the evening.
It's my pleasure tonight to introduce you, if you don't know Jay Hoar, he's been working in the Civil War for many years and particularly Maine's role in the Civil War. And he's one of the people, I think one of those treasures we have in the state of Maine, who has a great expertise on a topic that's of interest to many of us. And Jay, of course, is a Maine native from the Rangeley area. Of course, he's taught at the University of Maine at Farmington for many years. He was a professor of Randy Bennett, so we'll have to keep that in mind as we go along here a little bit. And Randy has many memories of him, so I'm sure he made an impression on Randy forever. So, and he's here to talk to us about the young people, young men who served the Civil War. Those men, 11 and 14 or 15 and 60 maybe, and it's remarkable that we can, when you think about these young boys able to stand all the horrors of the war, it must have been an incredible experience for all of them. And, but of course, war was such a grim thing anyway, and he's going to give us his insights into some of these boys who fought in the Civil War. So without further ado, Jay Hoar.
A little over 3 years. theme, if I have one, or my motto tonight is truth is stranger and a thousand times more thrilling than fiction. That does not originate with me. It was on the cover of True Comics magazine. And I, somewhere here I see it. I have True Comics. And my first time away from home, I was in the hospital, the Farmington Franklin Memorial Hospital. I had a fractured leg, and it was my first time, as I say, away from home. It seemed a long way from home, Farmington, Maine. And this fellow from Rangeley brought in this True Comic magazine, 10 cents, and that marked me for life, I think, right there, because I became interested in history. And here he is, just a couple of years ago, he's still living, and that's Atherton Mitchell. And I'm 65, and he's 91 in that pitch. He's 93 today. But I took that up to him, and you know, I wanted him to know what an influence that had been on my life. And I have a stack of those this high. And anyway, across the front of it is that motto: truth is stranger and a thousand times more thrilling than fiction. And on the basis of my understanding of biography and history, I guess it's an understatement. I don't know that I'll ever get to write fiction, because nonfiction, real life stuff, is just so much more captivating. I had an old Reb, his name was Henry J. Scarce, S-C-A-R-C-E. And he had three wives and six children by each of the three wives in succession. Henry J. Scarce, 18 children. Now, you put that into a novel, let a novelist, and see if he can get away with that. People are going to say, well, he's just showboating, this is preposterous. And anyway, this is common stuff. His grandfather here, 107, this is his granddaughter. She's four. She's the youngest child of his youngest daughter by his second wife. He was, and put this in your novel and try it sometime. He was married 35 years his first time and 45 years the second time. I can't resist this. Now this is, here I am, and here is, I was researching for a fellow, Uncle Frank McGee. 4 years earlier, I had run across his name down in Raleigh, in the office of the state auditor. I was looking for the last old Rebs in North Carolina. And this ledger mentioned a lot of, you know, this was the last Confederate pensions. You might have a dozen women's name, and then here's a man's name. That's a real Confederate veteran. And among them was Frank McGee, 112. And he was black, and I had made a lot of progress on the other old Rebs that I discovered, but I couldn't get much information. Couldn't pry anything loose out of Oxford, North Carolina, where he lived. So I went there, and I found in my efforts to, he had grandchildren, you know, but someone said, have you been in to see Matt Harris over here? He's 112. So It turns out that Frank was 110, and Matt Harris was 112, and they belonged to the same church. He knew quite a lot about him, and lived to be 116. Well, that's me with Matt Harris. How many of you have had your picture taken with a 116-year-old? I've discovered that people do live to be 120. I have quite a few. Because, going back, it all started for me when I was 15 and 16. Life magazine had a pictorial of the last 30. Supposedly, they were pensioners, Union Army survivors, and Confederate veterans. 38 of them were pictorial. I looked around, and the nearest one to me was James M. Lurby of Goffs Falls, a suburb of Manchester, New Hampshire. And I just had to go see him. And I did, in June of 1949. And that is written up. I have it, the best place for it is Gettysburg Magazine, because he was the last survivor of the Battle of Gettysburg. And they couldn't resist that. They don't publish that type of story. But they could not resist this, you know, the fact that we have in James Lurby, and he would have been the last soldier veteran of New England when he died. September 17, 1950. So far, I haven't talked on my topic, but I promise to do that now. I spent 30 years, you could say, on the oldest and the last survivors. The last, there's an overlap here, dozen years or so. I've really been engrossed and captivated by those who were the youngest. A few of whom certainly did show up where you would think they might show up, among the very last survivors. It stands to reason that some of them would have been the youngest to be in the war. I find that they actually reached down to age 6 1/2. What were they doing at 6 1/2 and 7? I find that the very youngest echelon of soldier boys were valets or servants to their commissioned officer fathers. And because the patents have appeared here. If you were 8, 9, 10, 11, and probably 12, it's very probable that you had an older brother, or even more probable, your father was one of the officers in that company or regiment. He might have been the colonel of the regiment or the captain of the company. I very recently completed a story here on Henry David Davenport of Bethel, Vermont. Sorry. Henry wasn't quite 11. He's one of my more elderly 10-year-olds. And this is his father. This is Company H. And this is little Henry over here. He looks like a dwarf. He's only 10. And it's a beautiful story. He turns out after the war, his father is wounded, but doesn't die of the wound. He dies of sickness or disease. And Henry stays on and does his drumming for another 8 or 9 weeks, and then he goes home. But then this follows the pattern. He wants to go back, be in another Vermont regiment, and he is. This is the 6th Vermont. He wants to be, I think he gets into the last Vermont regiment, the 17th. did drumming all his life. He made percussion his livelihood, and he drummed in competitions. I visited his resting place in Bethel, Vermont. And another thing I've noticed about writing, you make a lot of friends. And my English teachers never really told me that. And they never told me how exciting nonfiction or writing about real things can be, and the rewards. I've been living on the heights of romance. And by romance, I mean going vis-a-vis, you know, with the highly unlikely or the hard to resurrect, and salvaging that which is about to be consigned to oblivion, and realizing that, getting this knowledge at the very last chance, because some of my personalities, well, let's take George Henry Jones here of Oxford, Maine. You know where Oxford, Maine is. Not very far, is it? And he was too old to be in this youngest study. He was 16. But he was trying at 13 to get in. And he finally got in on the tail end of the war. I'll pass this around. George Henry Jones, and notice there's four stars on his national badge. He's a commander in chief, Chief Jones. And in 1944, very late in the history of the GAR, he was the national commander in chief. They elected him, his comrades, in the Grand Army of the Republic. And you had to be a Civil War veteran to join that. California had a club that you had to be 100 years old to join and a member of the GAR. Not easy. They had 17 members. Maine had about 13 Civil War centenarians. And we had, as nearly as I can figure, about 90 or more Revolutionary War veterans that were centenarians. 13 that were Civil War, about 90 that were Revolutionary War veterans. Can you explain that? Because back then, in the Revolutionary War era, money wasn't worth continental, was it? But the land was something. And these veterans were given land if they would settle on it. A lot of the Massachusetts men, see, we had all our own veterans of the Revolution. Nearly all of them came back to Maine. But we got a lot from New Hampshire, Vermont, relatively, a lot from Massachusetts. And beyond, they came up here and settled huge tracts of land. We know this because to get 90 who were 100 or more in age, you have to have a pretty large base to work from. But that the land drew them here. And the Civil War veterans, they too were paid off in land quite often. Union Army survivors and the veterans, they had to settle on a piece of land for 1 year before they claim it as theirs. Confederate veterans had to put in 3 years to claim it. And a lot of them will do that over and over. Well, I'm just going to look at a few of these youngest ones. William Orlando Newbold Lee, L-E-A, of Hempstead, North Carolina, a Confederate. And it's amazing, too, and always on the watch for three generations who served in the Confederate Army in the same family. And this fellow was in at age 6, 5 months, 20 days, and he actually sustained a wound, a shell fragment, and had to wear a plate across the top of his head. He was a cabin boy in the state of Georgia, Greyhound. There were about 3 Greyhound vessels on the Confederate side, and he was part of the Mosquito Fleet, his grandfather. They ran off the coast of Georgia and the Carolinas, picking up supplies, mostly for the civilians. But his grandfather was the captain, and his own father was in the ANV, Army of Northern Virginia. And he died in Thunderbolt, Georgia. He was still living in 1928 at 72. Willie Henry Bush of Montesano, Washington, was 6 years and 6 months when his folks finally gave in. On his father's 3rd enlistment, Henry wanted to be, he wanted to see all the soldiers. He wanted to go to Washington and see President Lincoln. And here's a picture of him. Luckily, someone sent me this carte de visite, and I think it's a copy of what was sent to his mother. But here he is in his uniform, and he does not have any formal enlistment. But still, he's in uniform, and he went with his father, and the duty station was Elmira, New York, by way of Washington, D.C. And this is a picture of him. Yeah, maybe I'm going to pass these around, too. This fellow is known as Drummer George. How old is he, this boy? Drummer George. Bush was in the Veterans Reserve Corps up in Elmira, had a corporal's stripe. Quite often, for some reason, when these little fellows would have their pictures taken, somebody would always shove a bayonet in their belt and have them hold a revolver. And you'd think they were armed to the teeth, but of course they weren't. Today, worldwide, they are. They have semi-automatic and automatic firearms worldwide. 200,000 of them. But this is David Wood at age 10. He was in the Burns series on television. It showed that picture, but it didn't have him identified. It was on there for about 3 seconds. And this David Wood, by the way, had 2 daughters and a son. The 2 daughters, Dorothy and Frances Wood, were editors for Scott Bosman of the famous elementary school readers, Dick, James, Spot, and Clark. His 2 daughters did that. Yeah, so, but my source, you see, is those 2 ladies who brought out a book, I Hauled These Mountains In Him. He was a freighter out west. And even in the Army at age 10 and 11, he was a sutler. He was quite an entrepreneur even at that age. He was selling lemonade to the soldiers, and he expanded from there, had his own sutler's wagon. And he made $2,000 that way during the war. And his father was the colonel of the regiment. A lot of the southern youngest were home guardsmen, and The old men and the young boys formed up these kind of paramilitary units to protect the homes, because so many, especially on the southern side, most of the men were gone off to the war. We have Franklin Lafayette Wall, or Melly Wall. He was 7 years, 7 months, and 9 days when he became part of the Company C of the 21st North Carolina. Wilkes County Home Guard, and he was still living in 1938 at 82. You know, to be only 82 in 1938 as a Civil War veteran would be almost a contradiction in terms. Then I had a fellow, Benjamin Franklin Williams, or Uncle Tobin Williams, of Louvale. That's an unincorporated town today in Georgia, maybe 70 miles south of Fort Benning. He was a commissary wagoner in his father's home guard unit. He was in it about 7 and 9 months, so possibly as old as 8. And little known about, one of his ancestors was one of the last survivors of the American Revolution. That's a fascinating topic. Those veterans of the Revolution living during and after the Civil War. And that book has never been written. We have the illusion. The greatest and most captivating scenario for me is a history or biography that the world thinks has been written but has not. That's beautiful. And there was a Professor Hilliard during and just after the Civil War that went around and interviewed and took lovely photographs of the last veterans of the American Revolution in New England and New York and a little bit beyond that. But what about the other part of the country? The Revolution, you know, took place in the Middle Atlantic and in the southern states. Especially if you go see a film like Patriot, you realize the Revolution took place in the South too. Well, I challenge the readership of Confederate Veteran magazine out of Houston. And I gave them what I had on all the old Yankees that were the last. You can imagine how they warmed up to that. And I said, these are Yankee Doodle Dandies. And when I got the issue that featured it, they printed it, but I had to get out my magnifying glass. They were printed so small you could barely see those names. I challenged them. I said, I'm looking for some Dixie Doodle Dandies that were centenarians. Surely the South had some. Well, I got over a dozen. And also, I discovered one of them was 122 in 1832. It was 123, I guess it was. And I've learned quite a bit about him. So, but he was not living during the Civil War. The oldest veterans lived longer than we realize, and the youngest veterans were a lot younger than we realize. It's no secret that the youngest soldier boys were 15 and 14 and 13. That's not much of a secret, but being 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, and 7, the most people don't understand that. We have plenty of them. And Charles Connect, because he was still living in 1948 at 94, I discovered him quite early in late 1971, and that has not changed. He was 7 years, 10 months, and 14 days on his enlistment, and his enlistment papers are signed by General Henry W. Halleck, very high ranking, Northern General. And he was living in St. James, Missouri. He was in the Benton Barracks Cadets Band in Benton Barracks, Missouri, and the drum major was his father. I discovered that years later, and quite a bit of the story just from his father's Civil War record. So he was 1948, very young to be a veteran, and born in November of 1853. That's another tabulation. Edward Black of Hagerstown, Indiana, was 8 years and 1 month. He lived to be 19 because he died June 30th, 1872. Yeah, that's another tabulation, you see. The latest born. And my latest born is this Willie. Willie Henry Bush. And if I can find that, he was 1857. See, the war began, he wasn't even 4 years old when the war started, and yet he was in it. Bush, Willie Bush. My photographs, I wanted to talk here about John Richard Dimmock of the Maine's most famous GAR post down in Portland, the Portland Post 2. Dimmock was only 12 when he started his naval career, and he stayed in after the war, but he was a member, the youngest one, of the Bosworth Post 2 in Portland, which was at 44 Free Street, and hosted two national encampments, the 1885 and the 1929. And that was raised, that building was raised for a parking lot, and the Cumberland Civic Center is where that was today. I think they're talking about raising that for something else. Yes, I have even the names for this wall, the noms de guerre. I have 250 names for this wall. You have a different name for it depending on who you were, where you were, what you were. The Abolition War. You see, the Abolition War. And we can actually tell you whose name that was. That was Frederick Douglass, the famous Negro orator. There were black names for the war. The Red Time, the Red People's War, the Secession War, the American Iliad, the Brothers' War, the Cataclysm of 1861-65, Sidney Lanier, the famous Southern poet from Georgia, the blood-red flower that bloomed in 1861, a rich man's war and a poor man's fight, the Great Watershed Event, the Great War of Subjugation, the Great Trouble. Mark Twain calls it the Great Trouble in his fictional stories of the history of a campaign that failed. I would like to try this. I'm not a poet, but it just occurred to me. I seem to have one good poem in me every 6 years. This is called Impressive Little Grown-Ups. Drummer, mascot, marker, monkey. Little boy gray, little boy blue. Little girl nurse of either hue. Just what did you do in our sad fray? Was it Uncle Jeff's urgent call or Uncle Abe's? Did you carry a message, play a tune, act the spy? Stand guard, mark time. Were you foe or ally? Yours were billets suitable for babes? Weren't you really older? Could glory hunger so smolder? Your such few years seems unfair. Were grown men all that rare? Your service was based on need? Why, you could barely read. Tender soprano, all too willing. You, cherub face, on aching feet. What hateful, hurtful, haunting sights stole your peaceful slumber nights? Regimented innocence, martially schooled. Beardless, brave youngster, partially fooled. We honor you, the fledgling fair, the faithful forgotten. We honor you. Well, this callow, brave, and true is what I call this. Callow, well, you know, as an English professor, I had to choose some highfalutin word like that that nobody knows. Callow, brave, and true. A gospel of Civil War youth. So that redeems it, the last word, youth. Anything that's callow, is green with inexperience, is young. And that's what this is. It's the stories of their lives, all during their pre-war, what they were doing in the war, and what became of them after the war, where they lived, and how long they lived, everything about them. And it's the first book on this topic. First book-length study in existence. It's been around for a year this week. And that's what turns me on, if you like that phrase. Writing on something nobody else has touched. That's not an easy thing to do, but I've been unusually fortunate with these writing fields, the eldest and last survivors, and the very youngest. Another one that we had here in Maine, of course, was John E. Anglin of Portland, who he was going to school every day, but he could see this sloop being built for the Union Navy, the Pontusa. And he had the ambition that he was going to serve on that ship. And sure enough, he wangles this permission from his folks, and he gets on the Pontusa. And actually, he earns a Medal of Honor. And that was the only decoration, really, that the government had, by the way, at the time. And the requirements for it weren't quite the same as we understand them now, but they were still pretty awesome. I'm looking at a tabulation here, Appendix E. The youngest recipient of the nation's highest decoration, William Willie Johnston of Company D, the 3rd Vermont. And he earned it, I think, about the last two or three days he was 11 years old. What he did was he saved his drum. When everybody else was throwing away everything they had in a rout during the 7 days fight before Richmond, in the Peninsula Campaign, he was 11 years, 11 months, and about 20 days, maybe a little older than that. That's an estimate. But the thing about Willie Johnston, he's the youngest now, got this congressional medal. He disappeared. Nobody, but nobody, knows what became of him. And nobody cares. Nobody cares. Just me. and maybe a handful of others. Now, I guess I'm a freak because I want to know. I'd like to find out whatever happened to him. I learned one new piece of information. I have the largest piece of writing on him anywhere around in this book, as much as is known. But I did learn, I think it was last November or December, he graduated after the war. You know, once the war ended, that was the last we ever heard of Willie. And he went in with his father, who was born in England, from St. Johnsbury. And he got out finally at the end of the war, that summer of 65. Well, that was the last real concrete information we had, except it was known that his drum and his medal surfaced in Chelsea, Massachusetts, about 1887. Apparently, he never married or never had any children, never lived long enough to get a pension. But he went to Norwich University over to Northfield, Vermont, and was a cadet in the band over there, and graduated in the class of 1870. And there is a book by Mr. Poirier about Norwich, the history of Norwich, and Willie gets one little paragraph on page 48. And you know, everyone's happy with not knowing what happened to this fellow. Where is he? He has stepbrothers and sisters that are buried in a little cemetery in Denver. And his father died in 1902 in one of the Western soldiers' homes. But Willie, it's a mystery. I've written to Unsolved Mysteries. Well, they said they weren't going to be on the TV any longer. This was 3 or 4 years ago. And they've since come back. I guess I'll try it one more time, but it didn't have enough violence to it. but that's a mystery that's been standing for 112 or 14 years at least. Just an example. Yeah, the next oldest one I have is this John E. Anglin, who was about, at the time of his earning the medal, he was 14. And at the time of his heroism, Orion P. Howe of the 55th Illinois was 14 and 4 months. Oscar E. Peck of USS Varuna was 14. James Snedden of the 54th Pennsylvania, he was 14 and 8 months. Nathaniel Gwynn, he was a black soldier, 13th Ohio Cavalry, he was 15 and 23 days. And John Cook of 4th U.S. Artillery, 15 and 1 month. I just want to sketch that in so you understand that the youngest for that medal goes way down to age 11 and 14. Then I have several pages here, Appendix C, Soldier Boy Casualties. People ask, well, weren't they protected quite a bit? And the answer is yes, quite a bit. But numbers of them died, either from wounds or from disease. Billy Bethune of the Company K, Georgia, he was 15, died of wounds. Felix G. Claiborne of the 18th Virginia died of wounds. If you ask anyone, you know, the name, a very young Civil War veteran. And a lot of them can't do it, but those who can will quite often name Johnny Clem, right? Johnny Clem, you've all heard of Johnny Clem, you've heard of Johnny Clem. You know. His name was John Joseph Clem, K-L-E-M, and he kind of Americanized it to C-L-E-M, and he changed his name to John Lincoln, C-L-E-M, Clem. There's no documentation on him at all until he joins or catches up with the 22nd Michigan. And you're talking September of 1862. The popular myth, and I use that word cautiously too, because it may be true, that he could have been as young as 9 years and 10 months. Supposedly, he joined in June of 61, but there's a lot of controversy. He's the hardest one to write about, and of course. He made the Army a career. General Grant gave him wanted him to go to West Point. General Thomas wanted him to go to West Point. But he wasn't tall enough, for one thing, and he really didn't have the education. But they sent him to an artillery school, and he made the Army a career. In fact, it was Clem who headed up the military rescue and forces of the earthquake in 1906 in San Francisco. He was retired as a major general in 1914. And that's an interesting question. He gets credit for being the last active officer of the Civil War on the active list of officers. And that's not true, because, and I can concretely, it's easy. That was Admiral Dewey. Dewey was a lieutenant in the Civil War and was in quite a number of naval battles. He was young. But Dewey, you know, he won the Battle at Manoa in May 1 of 1898. Yeah, he had a career. But the federal Congress passed an act. They made him, gave him the rank of Admiral of the Navy. And the other thing they did was said that he would never retire. And he died in January of 1917. So that's it, categorically, the last commissioned officer from the war. Maybe I've talked long enough. I sense I have. You give me my favorite topic, I could be here for the night. And I'd entertain a few questions, if such is yet.
You mentioned a number of young soldiers, ages 11 to 14, that received the Congressional Medal of Honor.
Yes.
Just briefly, what kinds of acts of bravery did they engage in?
Well, without having too much in front of me, let's see, Willie Johnson saved his drum. They found this out a couple of days later when they, this was a, that sounds kind of silly, but remember, he said, the drum's pretty awkward to say. The drum is kind of awkward, especially if you're that small. When the bullets are flying and everyone else is throwing away their arms and half of their clothing. But they call for a drummer for a division parade. And they discovered that there wasn't a single drummer in all those several thousand men. Willie Johnston was the only one that had his drum, so he had the honor of playing his drum for that. And this called attention to it, you see. And it went all the way up to Abraham Lincoln. Lincoln wanted him to be recognized. This boy needs, he deserves a medal or something. Angwin was in a shore party. He really, in a way, earned it twice at Fort Fisher, the bombardment of Fort Fisher, and they had a shore landing party, and he was among them. Orion P. Howe was at Vicksburg and the storming of the some heights there, and a lot of them got killed, and he didn't get killed, and he was 14. Oscar Peck on the Varuna, I think that was a ship that was sunk, and he was saving lives. Nathaniel Gwynn of 13th Ohio, there was 400 sharpshooters shooting at him, and a shell took off one of his arms, and he recaptured the unit's flag with one hand and held the stirrups with his teeth that I remember that for him. William H. Hossfall, Julian Scott of Vermont, he won a medal of honor at Lee's Mills. The Scott brothers are interesting, hard to resist them. I have a good full story on them in here. The way they got into this book, Julian Scott, the famous artist, had a younger brother, Charlie, who was 13, and was a veteran three times over by the time he was 17. Three different enlistments.
May I add a little bit?
Yes.
The children mentioned that Charlie was drunk.
Yes. The drumming was a key way to communicate.
Right. Yeah. And my grandfather enlisted when he was 15.
Yes.
And he played the drums all his life. And when he came back to Maine, he was drum major in a lot of bands around the state.
Yes.
Freeland, Hugh Andrews.
Yeah.
No way.
We'll have to jot that name down. You see, I got a tablet that's empty right there. So we'll get that name before the night's out.
Freeland Quincy Andrews.
Freeland Quincy.
Andrews.
Andrews. Freeland.
Right. He was also an artist. He painted portraits.
What the main outfit, was he in the main regiment?
I don't remember.
We'll find out down Augusta if he was in them. Is he buried in Maine, you know?
Yes.
So they have a card on him down Augusta.
He's buried in the cemetery down to Norway.
Well, any other questions or observations? I have about 15 now, or 16 10-year-olds. There is one place, and it's in Cora E. Gillis's final journal of the GAR, which was 1957, where she says that there were some 25 in the Union Army who were age 10 or under. But I can assure you that there were probably at least 75 or 80 who were age 10 or under, somewhere in that neighborhood that I know of. And that's it, just over time, chipping away at the same old thing. You gradually do get down to a bedrock of truth, but it takes time. And yeah, this Henry David Davenport, quite a story. And he belonged to an outfit that I didn't even know it existed, the National Association of Civil War Musicians. Yeah. And he was also, he has defeated Howard, champion of New York, Mason, champion of Massachusetts and New Hampshire, and has challenged Hendershot, the drummer boy of the Rappahannock. I have his full story. But this, unfortunately, I wanted, you know, I had a book three times this size, but they wouldn't take one 250 pages, and I managed to get 288. But that's the first and only book on that topic, even today. Gettysburg.
Those questions are there a lot, then.
Yes.
You mentioned in one of the earlier veterans that you were talking about that there was a black soldier from the Confederacy. Now, I knew
that they were body servants, yes.
Oh, so they weren't actually...
They were, supposedly, didn't bear arms. But sometimes I think they did grab up a firearm and maybe save the life of the man that they were in the war with. Body servants would be usually house servants of the wealthier Southern families. Sometimes it was a one-on-one thing, one body servant to one soldier, or sometimes a soldier had more than one body servant, and sometimes a body servant would be a servant to several Southern soldiers. But at least 90% of the Southern soldiers didn't have any servants. So they were exceptional. We got to bear that in mind. But they were Class B soldiers, as far as pensions, in most of the Southern states. They did draw pensions, but it was a Class B pension. If the white soldier was getting $76 a month, the black soldier, home guardman, I don't mean that, I mean body servant, would be getting about $26 a month. But yeah, there were quite a few thousand. And they show up, these blacks, on both sides, among the very last survivors. The late 30s and the 40s and the 50s. Michigan's last veteran was a Joseph Polisi, who came up from Louisiana. He was the last in Michigan by 3 years. I do want to say one thing, though. I have a 10-year-old nurse here, Susan Haynes Clayton. She was 96 in 1948, one of the last three Civil War veterans in Oregon. I don't believe she ever really got credit for that, but the Oregon History Quarterly were glad to have her story. And she nursed, her mother, they were Quakers, her mother was a nurse, taught her some of these nursing skills, and she was taken to Camp Carrington, just outside Indianapolis, by General Benjamin Harrison, later president. So her story is well documented, but she was 96 in 1948. She's in this book. Very pleased to have a 10-year-old nurse. It's beautiful material.